one of the reasons why we're here is to illustrate that it's not just what we're prepared for, but it's what the people that are working with us need to be prepared for. So let's say I'm a brand new tandem instructor, I'm a brand new videographer. I'm really excited to work with somebody who's very talented. We exit the aircraft. I exit late because I'm new and I get wrapped up into the drover. Next thing I know, I'm on top of them. What happens if I panic and deploy my pilot chute? Potentially all three of us could get injured or killed. If I deploy my reserve, all three of us could get injured or killed. So I'm using this context to explain that because emergency procedures happen so infrequently, and because these outlier events, videographers don't get caught in our drill bridles. We train for it, but it just doesn't happen. Because these things are so infrequent, we're not always prepared every time we go up. And it's not just how prepared we are, it's how prepared the people that we work with. And if you take that as the first note, if you guys are keeping mental notes or writing stuff down, when you go home, you want to make sure it's not just you, it's people that you're working with, that they're prepared for the same information and the same possibilities. Because despite the fact that there are higher likelihood of malfunctions like tension knots and line overs and things like that, there's also the not so common malfunctions like your videographer hung up in your drogue. But when it happens, you have to be prepared for it. I'm going to actually ask you to turn the camera off just while I run the video, because I don't have permission to publish it yet. Your situation: three people survived. Well, it was a pretty catastrophic event, because they all had the same plan. The instructor and the videographer were on the same page. They knew what each other was thinking. The videographer did not panic. He did not throw his pilot chute. He gave the instructor below him time to handle the situation. And if you go back and watch it frame by frame, you can see the cutaway handle flies past them, and then the bag main goes past them. The instructor cuts away. He tracks away. He deploys. He tracks away as he falls away, and then opens in clean air, and everybody survives. A really talented examiner of ours made sure that everybody in that drop zone was aware of this situation, this possibility, even if it wasn't likely. And instead of an incident report, we have tandem instructor and a videographer that have a great story to tell, and for us, a phenomenal training day. So I use that as the context to set up this presentation. And here we are, the Sigma Tandem Emergency Procedure Review. What we're going to look at today, some key factors: the statistics of emergency procedures, the complexity of the Sigma system, the confidence of knowledge, the confidence of knowing what we need to know. There's a few differences between federation and manufacturer emergency procedures, so we're going to cover that. We're going to cover the importance of completing the procedures, finishing the process. We're going to take a moment to talk about why the skyhook is not save-all. Okay, what our role as instructors are to allow the skyhook to do its job for you if you find it being utilized on your jump. We're also going to finish the sentence with "great power comes something." We'll cover that. Then we're going to talk about the effect of hand cam. This will be an eye-opening experience for you. And then I'll offer some conclusions and we'll take some questions. So in terms of the statistics of emergencies, malfunction percentages have gone down drastically. How many of you guys have ever jumped a Vector 2 tandem system? When you pre-flighted that gear, you had to pre-flight it like your life depended on it, because it did. You had to climb in there, look around, and then climb back out again before you put it on your back. Because back then, in the early days of tandem, we had a lot of pins and went across all manufacturers, pre-flighting pins, open containers and drogue fall. All this stuff was going on early on. And then Bill Booth determined that he was going to set out to fix a lot of the major problems we had in tandem jumping. The disc system stops the open container and drogue fall. The Collins lanyard takes away the broken RSL riser issue. And the skyhook almost removes entirely the unstable reserve deployment that we fear in tandem skydiving as well. So for the big three issues, we've come up with some great solutions thanks to Mr. Booth and the company. And in doing so, in improving the quality of the gear and the components, we've drastically reduced the malfunction percentage. Drastically. Most drop zones can go thousands of jumps between malfunctions. In Taupo, New Zealand, what was the figure, Mark?
21,000.
And how many malfunctions?
No, that was between malfunctions.
They went 21,000 tandem jumps without a malfunction. Mm-hmm. Now imagine tandem instructors making thousands of jumps a year over and over and over again, and after 21,000 instances, there's finally a malfunction. Should you be as prepared at 21,000 between malfunctions as 21? Absolutely. And that's what we're here to talk about, that percentages have gone down. So we have to make sure that because of that, our relative experience with emergencies is actually getting lower compared to our overall experience as instructors. Next question is, how many different emergency scenarios are there? Do you guys have any idea? We're always finding new ones, so there's no one actual number, but there's dozens of emergency procedures. There's lineovers, there's drogue handles potentially coming off if you're not doing your maintenance, there's broken lines, there's side spins, all these different possibilities. So my question for you is, within that entire spectrum of emergency procedures, are you prepared to handle all of them every time you go up? And if you're not, that's another area that when we leave this presentation, you're going to want to go back and look at this information, because what that first video showed us was that it's not just the things that we're expecting to happen to us that we have to prepare for, it's the things that we're not expecting to happen to us, but we still know are possible. A horseshoe malfunction is a highly unlikely scenario on a tandem skydive, but it can still happen, right? And how many of us are prepared to handle a horseshoe malfunction on tandem? If I were to ask you right now at the moment, what's the procedure for a horseshoe malfunction? And would you bet your rating on it? The answer. Or better yet, would you bet your life on it? Because ultimately, it's your life that hangs in the balance, right? And some of you might be sitting there quietly going, I think I know what it is, but I'm not entirely sure. That's okay to have that mindset here today, and I applaud you guys for taking the time to sit here with us to talk about it, because you're recognizing it in the best place possible, not on a tandem skydive. We're all human, we're all capable of forgetting things, so if you're finding through this conversation that you're starting to question some of your own internal processes and procedures and knowledge base, great, this is why we're here, why we're doing this. So you can go home and go back through the information before you make your next tandem jump. This is our emergency procedure tree that we have in the Sigma manual. So if you don't have this, it's available on our website, uptvector.com. I like to use it as a visual representation that the Sigma, despite all of its amazing advancements, is a very complex system. It's the Ferrari of tandem jumping. But imagine getting your driver's license and jumping behind the wheel of a Ferrari. Is that a good move, right? You want to learn how to drive, you want to learn how to understand the system before you jump behind the wheel of that complex system. The reason I offer that analogy is I want you guys to be comfortable with the idea that this is a very complex system that requires a very complex mind to operate it. So as you're training your instructors, you need to make sure that the knowledge base that they bring with tandem, or knowledge base that they bring from sports skydiving, is then expanded and applied into this very complex process. Most emergency procedure trees, they go up and outward, or down and outward. This is more of a shrub, because it actually goes about as far laterally as it does vertically. There's a lot of different possibilities that can go on in tandem skydiving today in terms of emergency procedure possibilities, and we have to be prepared for them all. So again, I highly recommend that you go home, download the manual, print out this page, laminate it, stick it in your locker, and look at it. Keep it active so that you have it to look back and check on. Okay, so to further expand on the complexity of emergency procedures for tandem, there's so many different areas we have to prepare for. Aircraft emergency procedures. Do we have a solid knowledge base of our exit altitudes? If we're below 1,500 feet and a minimum hookup and exit is one hook, do we know which hook we're leaving on? Well, you guys actually hook up all of your hooks before you take off, so that one might not actually be an issue for you. One of the differences in procedures between federations and manufacturers. What about exit procedures? Exiting an aircraft and the main pin opens on the door. Free fall procedures. What's free fall? Can we even do that in tandem skydiving? It's that 3 to 8 seconds between exit and setting the drogue. All those things that could go wrong, like side spins, like hard pulls, the drogue handle comes off. All these different potential free fall emergencies all have procedures. Drogue fall, there's things that can go on in drogue fall that we have to be prepared for. Deployments are what we're most prepared for, what we think of as the most likely scenarios. Bag locks, streamers, hard pulls, collapse, drogue, and tow, all these different possibilities. Are we prepared to handle each one of them? Canopy procedures. What happens when we have a line over or a hole in the canopy? And then landing procedures. What happens when a toggle comes off the control line? Is it an outboard or an inboard? Does that change the decision-making tree? These are all questions that we should be able to answer and answer confidently each time we put a tandem rig on our back before we go make a scout out of it, because we never know when our next tandem malfunction is going to happen. We should expect it's going to happen on that next jump. All right, this is an area that over the last few years have really noticed that we need to focus on as an industry, and that is the confidence of knowledge. My favorite three words in all of tandem skydiving, are you sure? It's not just what we know, we have to have confidence in what we know. We have to know and believe that this information is the correct information to use to keep us safe in the event of an emergency scenario. Why that's so important is that when we typically encounter tandem emergencies, we're falling towards the earth at about 120 miles an hour, possibly 180 miles an hour if we don't have a drogue out. Seconds are going by, and there's not very many of them. And what those seconds going by represent is altitude that we're losing. There's not much altitude between exiting an aircraft and the ground. So lack of confidence causes hesitation. Hesitation causes loss of altitude, indecision, or worse, it leads to incorrect emergency procedures. In almost every tandem incident in almost every fatal tandem incident since the beginning of tandem in 1983, in almost every one of them, there was some form of instructor error committed. Either the instructor failed to do something they should have done, or they did something they shouldn't have done. No different than aircraft in that regard. Pilots crash airplanes. Pilots fly planes in the ground. Most of the accidents are caused that way. Very rarely is it an equipment failure solely, and that only responsible for that incident. So we want to remove indecision from our emergency procedures. That's really the goal in all of this, is to be knowledgeable and confident so we can act quickly and correctly when experiencing emergency procedures. And it's not just our instructors. This is another area that I want to emphasize. Oftentimes, it's the guy with the most experience in the room. It can happen to our trainers. We've had numerous trainers who have made some of the most basic mistakes over the years, and it's not that they're bad trainers, and it's not that they're overexperienced, but they're human. They develop the same complacencies that anyone can develop. So being an examiner does not exempt you from making mistakes. Having 10,000 tandem jumps does not exempt you from making mistakes, and oftentimes when it comes to pre-flighting issues, I'm going to show you some videos on broken risers, it's actually the guys and girls that have 8,000, 10,000 jumps that have developed a sense of comfort and complacency that just put a rig on their back because they can handle it. They've done it 8,000 times, maybe had 3 malfunctions. They can handle it, it's not a big deal. Sometimes they're right, and sometimes they're wrong. Okay. Confidence under pressure. This is another issue. I'm gonna show you this in a series of videos shortly. Do you guys know what a cutaway handle feels like on a Sigma? Well, if you had to describe it to me, I can't see it. Describe to me what the cutaway handle looks like and feels like.
It's a pillow.
A pillow, that's what I was looking for. Pillow, it's rough, it's got Cordura of some kind of.
Okay.
Excellent. And do you feel confident here on the ground that if you had a broken riser, you could grab that cutaway handle and put it in your hand and know that that's the handle in your hand, right? Hopefully the answer is yes, and it should be. We'll come back to that in a moment. And lastly, would you bet your rating on your confidence level? When you ask you questions about emergency procedures, and when you're drilling yourself question and answer, are you willing to bet your rating? What's the emergency procedure for a drogue in tow? Okay, try primary, try secondary, we can't find it, we activate the reserve. Would you bet your rating on that? If not, go back to the confidence of what we're talking about. That we need to not just know the procedures, but we need to know them quickly and efficiently. Okay. Right, I'm actually going to pause this here for a second and go back to my videos. And I'm going to have you turn the camera off for just a moment, if you would. The outcome is that they land a reserve parachute cleanly. But in this instance, he wasn't prepared for it. And that's where I'm here trying to prepare you guys for that possibility. So that's one instance. Now here,
you can turn the camera back on.
Yeah, you can turn the camera on this one. All right, so this one, it's the same situation. It's a missed the flip through that was missed by the instructor. This happens to be one of our examiners. He's been doing tandem jumps since 1983, has a drastic, dramatic amount of experience, thousands and thousands of tandem jumps, has trained other instructors, and missed a flip through. Here's his flip through. Same broken riser, same half a canopy. You can hear him laughing, he's under a clean reserve. Why did one incident end up with broken legs and broken hips, and the other one ended up with a slightly embarrassed instructor who came down and sent us this video as a training aid? Because one of them was prepared to handle that emergency procedure, the other one wasn't. And had the confidence to maintain his composure during that event. Okay, back to our Okay, so in terms of federations versus manufacturers, BPA has its own emergency procedure tree for training for tandem. Whether it's Sigma, Strong, or anything else you have here in the federation, what I would ask you to do is take your BPA procedures and compare them side by side to the Sigma procedures. You might find something is contrary, like the hookup sequence in the plane, because you, as an industry, or excuse me, as a federation, require all points of attachment on a tandem before even taking off. So that might be a noticeable difference. Some of the federations blend the procedures together for the different manufacturers, so you might actually find, well, good intentioned, that there might be a conflicting piece of information between the BPA tandem emergency procedures and the UPT tandem emergency procedures. And that's not necessarily to say that your procedures are wrong for what you're doing, but if there is a discrepancy, the time to find it is on the ground, now here in a calm environment of a training location, and then talk about it, give us that information so we can have a dialogue with you. We might educate you to a position where you might want to change that procedure, or you might listen to our side of the story, so to speak, and be comfortable with what you're doing and continue on with it. But either way, you'll be making an educated decision on the discrepancy between procedures if they exist. And some of them do exist in other federations like Australia and New Zealand. There are certain federation differences, but we just need to know that they can vary. We need to know why they vary. We should all have the mindset that tandem systems shouldn't be combined when it comes to emergency procedures, because each system is built differently and handles different procedures differently, handles different scenarios and situations differently. And whatever those differences are, note them, address them, and educate yourself. Okay, another thing that we've seen recently that is really becoming problematic in tandem skydiving is the reliance on what?
The drogue.
Exit stable. That's another presentation for another time. You need to exit stable, then set a drogue. Flying your body during deployment. We're going to talk about hand cam before this presentation is over, but it's not just with hand cam. When you find yourself in high-speed malfunctions, you need to keep flying our body, bag locks especially, because when we bring our arms in and leave our legs out, we tend to go head low, increases our chances of instability. If we're filming a hand cam and leave an arm out, we have the potential to roll over on our back. So I cannot emphasize enough that for emergency procedures, flying your body, clearing your risers, this is probably the most problematic issue our industry is facing right now, is that tandem instructors are cutting away during emergency procedures, but they're not ensuring separation of the risers during the process. And it's not entirely their fault. It's mostly their fault, but not entirely their fault, because as AFF students, when we first learn how to skydive, you ever see students walking around a drop zone going like this, or we were trained to just pull handles. Very rarely are students trained, unfortunately, to visually inspect to make sure that the risers have cleared. There have been a lot of reserves fired past main risers that are still attached because tandem instructors have cut away and they failed to ensure that the risers have cleared. How do we ensure risers have cleared? We start with a visual inspection. Right? If they're gone, excellent, proceed to the next step. But if they're not gone, we have to physically clear the risers. If you can bring that back to your drop zone, if you take nothing else away from the 50 minutes we spend together, if you can take away the reminder that every breakaway needs to have clear separation of risers, whether through the equipment or through physical assistance if needed, if you can do that, you will make this industry and this federation that much safer in the tandem industry. Deploy the reserve. This is a point of heartache for me, heartburn. Instructors rely on the RSLs and Skyhooks to deploy the reserves for them. The majority of the videos we see, the reserve handle is still firmly seated in its pocket. They don't finish their procedures. So I would encourage you guys and girls to make sure that you have a mindset that emergency procedures have a starting point and a finish point. And the finish point should be with the reserve handle being extracted, giving yourself all the possible options for success. It's very disheartening to be doing an accident investigation and see a reserve handle still attached and the riser still attached that the instructor hasn't cleared and didn't pull the reserve. He relied on his cutaway handle, but for whatever reason, which we'll cover in a moment, the reserve didn't come out and the risers didn't release. Okay, which brings me to the Skyhook is not a save-all. It's an amazing piece of equipment, but it is a subsystem within a subsystem within a system. It's only one piece of an entire complex process. Unfortunately, as an industry, we have a relatively new generation of tandem instructors that have an overconfidence in the Skyhook. They can do anything. They can be make stupid mistakes. They can take chances. They can do all kinds of crazy things because I've got a Skyhook on my back. But there's so many possibilities of the Skyhook not actually being involved in the emergency situation, the procedures. For example, we just saw an examiner miss a flip-through. It's a pretty glaring thing to miss, right? But still possible. Is it possible to miss an RSL snap shackle that's failed to be reattached? Do we disconnect our RSLs in high wind days? Absolutely. That is a classic situation where the instructor on the first jump disconnects the RSL, the instructor on the next jump grabs the rig and fails the pre-flight, doesn't reconnect the RSL, has a breakaway from a tension knot, cuts away, expecting the Skyhook to do its job because he has an overconfidence, but he failed to reconnect his RSL, and what ends up happening? Nothing. Falls away, and not only does he fall away, he now starts to go unstable because he's sitting there waiting, and nothing's happening. And now he's forcing unstable reserve deployment. Any of you guys riggers in here? What is the Skyhook attached to? The red loop? The red Skyhook lanyard, right? Is it possible to fail to put the loop through? If you forget the red thread, is it possible for the loop to slide off during the pack cycle? So if there's no lanyard hooked to the Skyhook, what happens? Nothing, right? So, unlikely scenarios, but possible. And in most of tandem malfunctions and incidents, it seems today we're working with unlikely scenarios. That's why I keep bringing them up. So when the rig is packed correctly, when the RSL is connected, yes, the Skyhook does give you a greater likelihood of a stable, clean reserve deployment, but you can't rely on it because rigging errors are going to happen. RSLs are going to be missed. We have to prepare ourselves and expect that these sort of things are going to happen on our jumps and treat our emergency procedures accordingly. Okay, so I said earlier we were going to cover with great power comes great responsibility. I used to call it the Spider-Man quote, but it's actually Stan Lee, the author of Spider-Man. With great power comes great responsibility. You guys choose to use the most technologically advanced tandem system in the world, the Sigma, the system that has resolved the majority of the major issues in tandem malfunctions. But with that great power comes the great responsibility of knowing your procedures. I cannot emphasize that enough. It's the brain that's going to cause the problem, not the system. Okay? It's the inability to be able to handle emergency procedures that are going to cause the incidents. So you need to respect the equipment. Absolutely, you have to stay current. This is what I'm here to ask of you. In the US, we require once a year seminars. The rating renewal seminars. It's not enough. We need to be looking at emergency procedures at least every 30 days. There have been studies that if we teach you information like emergency procedures over the course of a 3-day tandem course, and you never look at that information again for 30 days, you will have forgotten 90% of it. Now imagine if I were going to take one of your friends or family on a tandem jump, and I said, hey, I'm going to go take them on a jump, and I have 10% retention of my emergency procedures that I'm sure of. Would you feel comfortable letting me do that? I would hope not. We want 90-100%. We want you to have a confidence in all the material, and the only way to maintain that confidence is to look at it month by month by month. Make flashcards, have meetings, question and answer sections or sessions. But you have to stay current on the information, otherwise you will forget it. And even if you don't forget it, you might not be sure about it. And that's just as dangerous as not knowing it. So what I'm asking you to do is see the big picture. Tandem skydiving is not like sport skydiving. It's not like any other skydive. It's complex. It's two bodies, two heads, four arms, four legs, falling through the sky with a self-induced drogue in tow. It's a complicated process. We need to treat it that way. When done correctly and safely and with the knowledge base of not just standard procedures but emergency procedures, you guys can have decade-long careers, two decades, three decades-long careers, bringing more people into our sport. You have to take that big picture view that just because tandem's gotten safer equipment-wise, we as human beings are getting more and more unsafe to keep the incident rate constant. And as it comes to Sigma, Bill Booth has said repeatedly that he's made the system as good as he can make it. There's going to be additional benefits, maybe materials will get better, there'll be slight improvements, but the big issues we had have all been solved. Open container and drogue fall, unstable reserve deployments, broken RSL risers, we fixed those problems. The only major decrease in incidents that's going to occur in our industry is on your shoulders. You, the instructors, have the ability to lower the incident rate by increasing your knowledge of the procedures that you're using. We have the data. Like I said, there's been over 70, Frank, how many? 75 tandem incidents with over 125 fatalities. 69, 124 or 5 fatalities. Almost all of them, except for one or two, have been entirely driven by instructor either making the bad decision, doing something they shouldn't have done, or failing to do something they should do. Where the instructor could have changed the outcome to a successful one had they been armed with the correct knowledge. And possibly, as far as the first video we showed with the trauma there in the broken riser, and been prepared for it, so when they are in that traumatic situation, they have the information on recall. Okay, we're doing good. We got a couple minutes left. All right, now we're going to talk about the hand cam effect. Since you guys probably can't see up here, I'm going to read it for you. Just because you have a malfunction doesn't mean you should ever miss the shot. I make this shit look good. Would like to thank my rigger too. Okay. It's like fish jumping in the boat. These the people go on Facebook. You guys are tandem instructors, first, second, third, and fourth. Maybe you're videographers in terms of responsibility, fifth or sixth down the line. When it comes to emergency procedures, you have to forget about the camera. Can't emphasize that enough. And unfortunately today, when a tandem instructor sees attention on over their head, the first thing they're thinking about is, this is going to look awesome on Facebook. I got to make sure I get my hand out here to film the breakaway. We talked about the RSL disconnection. We talked about the skyhook lanyard not being attached. Is filming our cutaway part of emergency procedures? Is that in the BPA manual? Make sure you get it in a shot. I doubt it's there. Right? I haven't read it, but I doubt it's there. We have to make sure that we remove hand cam from our emergency procedures. Okay? We shouldn't be focusing on what's going to be put on Facebook or YouTube. We need to be focusing on the emergency procedure at hand and what's potentially going to happen. This is really this is serious, and it's serious for a number of reasons. So here we have a tandem instructor with a floppy jumpsuit, which means he has a lot of drag. He's got his hand cam out, and he ends up with a bag lock. How many of you are familiar with bag lock procedures? Bag lock, what do you do?
I cut away, and I had to clear the risers.
Love it. Clear the risers, okay? That's what we want to hear. And then?
Well, then, because of the RSL, the opening of the reserve is already happening for a
couple of years. Where have you been for the last 10 minutes? Somebody help him out. Somebody. Thank you. Pull the reserve handle after clearing the risers because we don't know if the RSL.
No, I understand where I was. I still pull the handle.
Yeah, okay.
The opening is already there. So.
In theory.
I will still finish the procedure.
Okay. Thank you. Bag locks should only be fatal if you try to land them. Other than that, we have a procedure to handle it, right? And Has anybody here had a bag lock? Did you survive?
Well,
the procedure works, is my point, right? It should work.
Yeah, when they all said to me, actually.
All right, turn the camera off before that one. No, the reality is here, again, is that we have a procedure for bag lock. It's a high-speed malfunction, but it's not a terrible malfunction to have if the procedure is followed correctly. Yet in this instance, we almost had a double fatality based solely on the fact that there was a hand cam involved. If the hand cam wasn't there, that does not turn into a double malfunction. But because the hand cam is there, and his left arm is left out to film it, they rotate over onto their shoulder. You can see the passenger's hair represents the relative wind. The right riser passed in front of his neck rather than departing behind him. So now the RSL, excuse me, the Skyhook lanyard is also now going to pass around his neck with the RSL. And now he's in basically a horseshoe with his reserve pilot chute. We had the Skyhook in service for over a decade, over 10 million jumps on the Sigma system, hundreds if not thousands of deployments of the Skyhook. What's different here? Hand cam. That's the adding something to the system that created a change in his procedures that led to potentially almost a double fatality. Now, it was over a decade of Sigma jumps with Skyhook without this ever happening, and then it happened. I'm going to ask you to turn the camera off for just a second to handle the procedures as though the hand cam is not there, that they have to clear the risers, pull the reserve handle, finish their sequence as though the hand cam is not there. So, hand cam effect. Instructors try to keep everything in frame. We're losing the perspective. We're tandem instructors. We're pilots. We're not videographers. The camera should not even be on our mind during either standard procedures or emergency procedures. Hand cam relying on the RSL to get the shot. We've talked about how that can be dangerous if not deadly. Clearing the risers on the two videos we just showed, if both instructors had simply cleared the risers rather than filmed the deployment, neither one of those double malfunctions would have occurred. Manually activate the reserve. One of the worst things we can find as investigators in an incident is that the reserve handle is still in its pocket with the Velcro cleanly mated. You should be doing everything you can to save your life, which includes finishing the procedures. And then fly your body. As we saw in terms of hand cam, flying your body is not this, flying your body is this. When the right arm comes in, the left arm is left out. We know what has to happen, we have to rotate. So make sure we understand the dynamics of flying the body. So in conclusion, we need to educate ourselves on emergency procedures. And it's so critical because we have so few emergency procedures, or excuse me, so few emergency situations. Once a year is not enough. You guys need to be confident in what you're doing and be sure. Confidence reduces stress, confidence reduces trauma, confidence ensures quick, timely responses to the situations that we encounter. And ultimately, we have to respect what we're doing. Being a tandem instructor is a privilege. A lot of us make a living off of it. And it's only gonna take the mismanagement of a few tandem jumps on a global level for us to potentially lose the industry that we all love and we all wanna be a part of. Tandem skydiving has become very easy when it goes well. With wind tunnels, we understand the dynamic of human body flight better than we ever have before. With equipment manufacturing processes and equipment testing facilities that we have today, the equipment is not just as engineering, it's not just the designs that are phenomenal, it's the structural integrity of the materials that we're using is better than we've ever had before. The testing that PD does on its canopy fabric is amazing. The pull test that UPT does on the harness and on the webbing, we know we can build you equipment that will outperform you. We need you now to meet the level of the equipment, okay? And as instructors, the hardest thing for us to do is fight complacency. I've got 5,000 skydives, about 3,500 tandems. I've only had two malfunctions. I've only pulled my reserve handle on tandems twice than 3,500 tandem jumps. So I know I'm not very current when it comes to emergency procedures. Thankfully, this is my job and it's what I do. I get to talk to people about it all the time, so it's current in my consciousness. But if I wasn't doing this, I'd be looking at my emergency procedures every month. Not just for the things that I expect to happen, but the things that I don't expect to happen, like the videographer that's stuck in my drogue bridle, the outlier events, the ones that were not necessarily, we may never see it once in our entire career. But if you only saw it once in 10,000 tandem jumps and a mismanagement of that jump could kill you and your passenger, would you consider that to be just as important as being prepared for the tension knot, which might happen once a season? So if I can leave you with that philosophy and the idea that you want to go back to your drop zone, have staff meetings with the people you work with. All of our information is on our website. Pull it down, look at it. Whether you agree with it or disagree with it, go through it all. And if you have questions, contact us, get information, because not knowing is not an excuse. I can't emphasize that enough. The three most important and most powerful words in tandem jumping, are you sure? The three most dangerous words in our industry, I didn't know. And I investigate tandem accidents throughout the year. It's an unfortunate side effect of my job. The majority of them, thankfully, people are still alive to interview, but occasionally we have to look at hand cam video for the last moments of someone's life. It's basically like a black box, and it shows us what's happened. And the ones that we are able to still talk to the people, the answer is always the same: I didn't know. I was presented with a situation and I didn't know what to do. And that is shocking and scary, but it's easily correctable. So I want to leave you guys on a positive note, not that downer, is that you have the potential to change an industry. You have the potential to lower the incident rate, not just here, but around the world, by making sure you're current with the procedures. The BPA is one of the best known industries. APF, BPA, and USPA, these three industries, these three federations, the majority of the other federations look to as the guiding light of how to do things. So if you guys are doing it right, it means the others are gonna do it right. The people that come through here for the summer, when you guys travel overseas over the winter and spread that knowledge, that information, you can actually affect a global population of instructors, not just your locals here. So take that with you. I thank you for the opportunity to talk to you and appreciate the attention span. I can see everybody's actively involved. It's 10 of now. If I can answer any questions for you guys, I'd be happy to. My email is tom@uptvector.com. You can always contact me there or on Facebook. If anybody has any questions, I'll be around for the remainder of the day today if you want to talk about something offline and don't want to discuss it in front of a group. The only thing that's dangerous here is lack of knowledge. If you know the information, you put yourself in a position to make the best decisions possible, not just in your standard procedures every day, but in emergency procedures that you may only see once or twice in a career. So, I thank you for your time. If I can answer any questions, I'd be happy to do so now. So, yes, sir.
One I often hear is we've here got established drogue in tow, you pull both releases,
yes,
you pull the reserve. I hear the argument quite often that, well, I'm going to do a full cutaway because I pulled for the container.
Okay.
I don't know when the plane's going to come out. I was interested in what the UPT, what you're doing.
Okay, that's a great question. So, whether to cutaway or not cutaway, which came first, the chicken or the egg? We don't know. It could go either way. Look at it from the perspective of open container, closed container. If you're in a drogue in tow on a Sigma, and you've pulled the primary, and you've pulled the secondary, and nothing's happened, the container is still closed. For some reason, we don't know why, maybe it's a broken bungee, there's something going on back there, that the pin is still in the loop, and that the main pack tray is closed. If the main pack tray is closed, we go straight for the reserve, and that's why we don't have the cutaway as part of that process, because the old Vector system was a little different on the deployment. On opening shock, the main canopy could potentially fall. You could pull the Vector ripcords and not have a main canopy, but the three ring had been released, and then opening shock would open the three ring. So the Sigma is a newer version of the Vector 2 tandem system. Pack tray is closed, we go straight for the reserve. If the pack tray is open, we've started a deployment process, that's when the cutaway, and you'll see in the sequence of emergency procedures in the manual, as you get to open container, now the reserve handle, or now the cutaway handle will be pulled before the reserve.
Okay. So moving that on one, so the container's open and the drogue's detached, the drill is still in the reserve handle.
Cutaway. If the container's open.
And you've got a detached drogue bridle.
Correct.
All right. Okay.
Anyone else? Hey, Chris. Are you in it too?
Hmm?
Are you in here next? Okay. Yeah, we're all wrapped up here. Any other questions?
Well, speaking to a couple of USPA instructors over the past 3 weeks.
Sorry, say that again.
Speaking to a couple of USPA tandem instructors over the past 3 weeks, some very experienced, that I'm led to believe, are talking about approaching the USPA reference and negating the handicap issue by putting on the student. This is people I've been talking to in Florida. I just wondered your thoughts on what they're discussing and thinking of taking to the USPA.
As a company, BT doesn't have any issue whether the hand cam is on the student or on the instructor, with the caveat that if it's on the student, it cannot interfere with the student's performance. And by that, what I mean is student landing, their hand should be in the harness, their legs should be up, but if their hand is out videoing their landing rather than doing what they're supposed to do, that would increase the potential for an incident. We would have a problem with that. If on exit, instead of maintaining a neutral body position that we train for exit, if they're leaving an aircraft like Superman, we would have a problem with it. As long as it doesn't affect the student's role and obligation in that skydive, and they do have things to do in that jump, then we want to make sure, as long as they're making sure that the hand cam isn't affecting that, we wouldn't have an issue. It actually takes away some of the instructor can now focus on his job a little bit better because he's not handing it. We don't do that much. Anybody else? Awesome. Oh, yes.
I hear this from other instructors as well. I know what I personally do. But so you're in a side spin, you can't stop it, you can't get on the back, you're in a established side spin. Right side down. You know, in here on our BPA, it's the YouTube full reserve. But some old school say, you know, I want to pinch and drove and see if I get lucky.
I think it says it might be advantageous.
Yeah, exactly. I just wonder what your opinion on it. I mean, me personally, I prefer the drove because I don't want to be spinning like a top foot and reserve up. I'd rather get an entanglement with the drove and then end up with the reserve up. I wonder what your opinion is.
There's a handful of emergency situations, such as that drogue side down side spin, that we can make recommendations for, but it's not a clear cut A will turn into B. We know that.
Appreciate that.
Yeah, we know that there are certain malfunctions. Cutting away, blowing the reserve, that is the process with clearing the risers. But the drogue side down, side spin reserve deployment, you risk the structural failure of the canopy riser assembly, which actually happened in Namibia, I believe. It was a mismatch of pieces. It wasn't one tandem system. It was one company's reserve, another company's harness container system, and they ended up having structural failure of the reserve during the deployment on their reserve, and then they rotated for dozens of revolutions and had a high speed deployment. The best answer I can give you is resolving it before you get there is the best solution. You know, side spins can be stopped. Anybody been on a side spin before? Did you survive?
Yep.
So they can be stopped. Stopping them before they develop into that period and they have to make that decision is the best solution. But the Sigma system reserve side down and a side spin is designed to be able to withstand that, so it should be able to get out into clean air. There is the philosophy, well, I don't want to give up my reserve. If I throw my main pilot chute or my drogue and I end up with an entanglement or I end up with a broken main canopy, at least I can then reserve, convert the reserve. There is no one pure answer to that, but it's really at that point to make the best decision to save your life.
It's a gray area then.
Yeah. Awesome. Cool guys, I'm around all day, so if you have any questions, please feel free to come by me and ask.